My name's Rich Malika. I'm on the pastoral team here at Cornerstone Christian Fellowship. And I just want to say I'm with James. If nobody else got anything, he and I sure did. It's a blessing to be here with you.
Amen.
And we're going to start in the Word, Luke chapter 12, verse 13, is our key scripture. I want to go through a little bit to give you some context. Someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." Jesus replied, "Man, who appointed me to a judge or an arbiter between you?" Then he said to them, "Watch out, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions." Anybody ever hear that before? I haven't heard that lately. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions. And he told them in this parable, "The ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. He thought to himself, 'What shall I do? I have no place to store my crops.' Then he said, 'This is what I'll do. I'll tear down my barns, I'll build bigger ones, and there I will store my surplus grain. And I'll say to myself, you have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy, drink, eat, drink, and be merry.'" Anybody ever had this fantasy? Am I the only one? All alone. Okay. Thank you, Mac. God bless you, brother. "But God said to him, 'You fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves, but is not rich towards God.'" The word of the Lord. I want to tell a story. There is a movie out right now about John Paul Getty called All the Money in the World. In the 70s, he was considered the richest man alive. Today, his fortune would be worth $9.1 billion. I can't conceive of that number. You can have several hundred million dollars and still be poor to this person. That is how much money he had. His grandson was kidnapped, and his son called him, and his daughter-in-law called him frantic and said, "We need the money. Please pay the money." And he said no, he just didn't take the call. Then they got a package with proof they were harming this young man. I won't get into the proof. And he said, "Okay, I'll help, but here's how I'll help." They asked for $3.2 million. He only gave $2.9 million because that was the maximum amount that was tax deductible. He gave the rest as a loan to his son, but required that his son pay him back at 4% interest. They got his grandson back, returned, permanently damaged from the experience, but returned, and his mother said, "Call your grandfather and thank him." He called, Getty was there, and he said, I don't want to talk to him," and did not receive the phone call. Later, he was married to his fifth wife, and their son was diagnosed with a brain tumor. And his wife, in her memoir, after they had divorced, said that he scolded her, screamed at her, berated her, because she was spending too much money on his care. She was being wasteful. They divorced after he did not go to this young man's funeral at age 12. What does that? How do we get to the place where this is how we live our lives and how we move with people? What does that? My first response to this is to align with his wife and with his grandson and his son, and to look at him as a demon. It's easier to do that. The real question is, how do we shift? Because this is all of us. All of us have a heart, and all of our hearts can be molded and formed in different ways. We are not separate from him. He's not somebody we can look at and say, ugh. He's someone we need to look at and say, how? And how can, and is there any part of me that's like that, that's forming in that way? That's the deeper question. Watch out, be on your guard against all kinds of greed, says Jesus Christ in the scripture. All kinds of greed. Money, yes. Not just money. I say money, yes, because we can breeze over it real quick and be like, ooh, thank God. Talk about something else I feel more comfortable with. Money, yes, but not just money. In this scripture, Jesus flips the script of what starts off. A guy comes to him, very culturally normal in this culture, to walk up to a rabbi and say, I'm having this dispute, can you settle it? Can you help it? This guy is moving correctly. And all of a sudden, Jesus flips it from this guy, his brother, and money, and makes it about this guy and God. Imagine if you walked up to Pastor Tracy after the service when everybody's hanging out, you brought up a conversation, and she was like, you and the Lord, in front of everybody. That's what happens here. You know, that's shocking, jarring. Why does Christ make this about this man's relationship with God? Because that's what everything, that's what John Paul Getty, that's what this person coming to Jesus Christ is struggling with. It's not about anything other than the relationship with God, because the belief is, as we heard earlier, the belief is that God's not enough. The belief is that I need $100 and God only has 50 cents in the account for me. And I need to make it happen. I need to control it. I need to do the work that God won't do, can't do for me. That is the fear. I want everybody to just say with me real quick, and I love pre-worship. I love worship because it was everything I'm preaching. I felt like I could get up here and be like, it's been fun, y'all. Amen. Because, here's what I want you to say. In Jesus, I have all that I need. And more. In Jesus, I have all that I need. And more. One time more, let heaven hear you. In Jesus, I have all that I need. And more. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Whatever we worship, we conform to.
Yes, true.
Our hearts conform to. Our lives conform to. We become. It's easier to see that when you hear this guy, and you're just like, how could you even make those decisions? I don't even understand. I would give all the money away and then beg for money to help my kid who's struggling with cancer. How do you even get there? It's easy when you see someone who's worshiping a drink or a drug or worshiping an unhealthy relationship to see how they conform to that idol, to that worship. Anything. Doesn't matter what. Pogo sticks, Pez dispensers, anything that we put on the altar of our soul distorts the image of God within us. Because God is the only thing possible that can fill that void and that can restore who we are truly meant to be. Instead of, amen, amen. Anything, when we take Lord Jesus, and we might have him on a little piece of the throne. He's got a good, you know, if you ever have to share a seat with somebody on the bus or something, he's got a little space. But he's not on the throne. He's not all there. Anything that we take becomes Lord. Lord money, Lord power, Lord sex, Lord relationship, Lord control, Lord drug, Lord security. They become what we conform to. I have an example that I'd like to show of people who are worshiping an idol and becoming distorted by it. This is coming from Enron back in the day. And these guys are talking about fires. And this is kind of poignant now, but you see the devastation in California. That was happening at this time. And it was devastating people, it was devastating land masses, but it was also driving up their profits. So let's watch this for a moment. I was never comfortable on the trading floor at an on. And if I had questions, I didn't ask them because I didn't want to know the answer. I didn't want confirmed what I suspected might be true. That what I was doing was in fact unseemly, or was at least unethical, if not worse.
Why did the trip?
That's good. Listening to devastation, there was another video I couldn't find that I saw before where when 9/11 occurred, people were screaming joyfully, look at what gold is doing. Look at what's happening to gold. I'm not different than these people. We're not. If I put anything else on the altar of my heart and soul, I will conform to it. Possessions of any kind are not meant for love.
Oh, say that again. Say that again.
Possessions of any kind are not meant to be love. There are two channels for love: God, who is love, and my neighbor as myself. Anything else I put on the altar of my heart, anything else that I pour my love onto, will distort me and affect those other two relationships. Has to.
True.
Say it one more time.
Anything that we love, that's a material possession, that's a position, that's a status, it doesn't even have to be a thing. People's praise, anything that I put on the altar of my heart, and anything that I pour my love onto, will affect my relationship with God, and will affect my relationship, my love of neighbor and self. Mm-hmm. There is not another option. Mm-hmm. There's not a way to negotiate that where we can fit both in. Doesn't work like that. Mm-hmm. Joni talked earlier about limitations. And I would like to submit to you that John Paul Getty's $9.1 million, or $1 billion, apologize, was a limitation to him.
Wow.
His love of that was a limitation.
Right.
Any, giving that over, it's like a clogged pipe. His pipe to God, his pipe to neighbor, his pipe to his child who was suffering and his wife who was grieving, was clogged by $9.1 billion. Giving up our limitations sometimes means giving up things that are extremely desirable. How many people would turn that down today? $9.1 billion. Anybody jump up? God will put us in a place where we have to sacrifice what we want or things that are even good. Intrinsically, money's not bad. The Bible doesn't say that. You'll often hear people say, but money's the root of all evil. This quote. Anybody say it with me? The love of money is the root of all evil. Things aren't bad. Things are meant to serve love of God and love of me. Any of the blockages, any of the things that I've placed my love, my faith, my hope, my joy in, are blocking what God actually has for me. And even if it's $9.1 billion, I am richer. I am wealthier.
Yes. Come on.
I am happier.
Yes. Amen.
If it all burned up in a fire.
That's right.
And I received what Jesus Christ has.
Amen.
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 I'd rather have Jesus.
Amen.
Anybody want to shout
Amen.
That out again?
Amen.
I'd rather have Jesus.
Amen.
And say it one more time, because Jesus has what I need. and more. What happens when there's right alignment? We're talking, we're seeing what happens when it's distorted. What happens when there's right alignment? One thing I just want to say off the bat, I've seen people come in here, and I know other people have as well, whose lives were focused on an idol, whose lives were focused on something that was destroying them. And watching those people blossom, watching light come back in their face, watching them walk in freedom again. I can't always express it with the passion I want to, because you would kick me out of this place. It is the best thing in the world to watch someone's lights come back on, because God has taken the right place.
That's right. Amen.
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 What God gives us, first off, eternal salvation. I think it was Charles Spurgeon who said, "He is no fool who gives up what he cannot keep for what he can't lose."
That's really right.
Whatever we give up for eternity in Jesus Christ is worth it. More than that, because it's not just about eternity, it's about here. It's about here right now. The fruits of the Spirit, let me put the scripture up. The fruits of the Spirit are love. How many ways do we see people who don't trust God? Now I'm preaching to myself. Try to control, try to organize their lives in ways where they just get that need from them. Love of the crowd. Whatever it is, it never fills it. Ever. But when we give our lives to Jesus Christ, when we receive the love that God has for us, it doesn't just fill us, it overflows from us. Joy. I never did anything in my life that gave me joy for more than 5 seconds that wasn't in Jesus Christ. And whatever joy it gave me left me more depleted. Peace. Want to quantify peace here, not numbness, not oblivion, not situational calm. This is a peace where even though your life is hectic, things are going popping off all around you, there is still a peace in our souls. Amen? It's a peace where people look at you and say, how are you like that? I don't understand that. I want that. Patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. These are the things that are behind every pathological, controlling, idol-filled thing we desire. God gives them in abundance. I have life for you, life abundant. Recently, a friend of mine, well, I'm not sure if they're here today or not, said, I left a situation where I had everything I needed. I had a nice place. I had all these possessions. I had all this stuff. And now I don't have. God bless you. I'll have a good one.
See you guys.
And now I literally have nothing material at all. I left all of it. I'm happy. I feel peace. I feel joy. And it doesn't make any sense. Everything that I thought I wanted, I don't have. And I want to cry because I'm grateful. That is what happens when we put God back on the throne. I have a second clip that I think speaks to this and also speaks to the pouring out. We don't just receive from God. We become the place where other people receive from God.
Thank you.
My family did not have enough money at different points to feel comfortable to have access. We felt called to give. And I have to tell you, I'm a human being. I look at the list of stuff, and I look at the giving. And it was hard for us. I got more after giving than I had prior. Giving up the things, the idols in my life, even good things, the idol of being in a relationship, the idol of having a child, are not bad things. They're good things. God wants to bless us with good things. But making them an idol, putting them on the place in my heart where God goes, stole my joy, stole my peace. In giving them over to God, I was able to receive what God had for me. But it felt like dying. There is a death, we die every day, the scripture says. I had to let that control, illusion of control, die so that Christ could live in me. And that is what God calls all of us to do. There's a picture I couldn't find either where this little girl is holding on to a stuffed animal that big and saying, I don't want to give it up. And Jesus is standing in front of her with a stuffed animal the size of the front row, saying, like, I have better for you. Please believe me. Give up your limitation so that I can give you what I have. I want to talk about a different wealthy person to close this out. And this is St. Francis of Assisi. Not a sissy. He's not a sissy. Francis of Assisi. St. Francis was wealthy. He was from the upper class. He had everything he needed just from his family's fortune. And he loved excess. He loved drinking. He loved hanging out with women, eating good food. He loved the lifestyle. It was all he was. And then one day, it all turned to ash. It did not please him. He got no joy. He got no peace. It was dead. He was empty. And that period lasted for 4 years, where he was doing the same thing but not getting life from it. Has anybody ever been in that situation? God called him to give up everything. He gave up all the money, gave it to the poor. He gave up all his possessions. He gave up all his authority. He gave it all to Christ. I don't think God calls all of us to give away all of our possessions, but I do think God calls all of us to have a place in our hearts where he is on the throne, and whatever he asks, we're willing to give it all away. And when the choice comes between loving God and loving my neighbor, or holding my security and my stuff, it has to go on the altar. It has to be sacrificed. That's the call. None of us does it perfectly, and usually I have at least a few minutes of deliberating with the Lord about it prior to my sacrificing it. But that is the call, because it's all a block. Whatever we're looking at, whatever we see, is not even comparable to what God has for us. The prayer of St. Francis, I think, articulates this point and how this man lived in Christ perfectly well. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, not so much seek to understand, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. And it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. Today, if you would like to receive the greater that God has for you, if there's something, a limitation that you need to lay at the altar, or if that you just want to say to God, I want it all, and I give you all. The altar's open. We're just going to have a moment of praise. Thank you all very much. Show you anything that's a block to receiving the greater. This is a time for that, for the Lord to speak. Thank you.
Thanks, Rich. lets us lay it down because he has more. We see laying it down as losing something. But he asks us to lay these things down because there's abundance on the other side of it. St. Francis of Assisi laid everything he had down. And it looks to the world that he lost everything and became this pauper. But he gained everything. He gained in his life more than enough and abundance. Let's stand for the benediction. This was a rich, rich morning. It was rich. Call it was rich. Rich, rich. Rich, rich. But I also, underneath the chairs are prayer cards that a group prays over them every Tuesday night. And aid send in prayer. If you have a prayer request, just grab that and put it in the box in the back. If you are visiting us today, we ask you to fill out one of our visitor cards and also put that in the box in the back. And our tithes and our offerings are taken by way of the boxes in the back. And I have to say this, you know, when we give to God financially, sometimes it does hurt. And I think about a few weeks ago, as I was writing my tithe check, and I was freaking out, because I knew the bills that we had to pay, and I knew what was next to them. And I paused, and I stared at it, and I'm like, I don't really want to write this. And I just heard the Lord say, let it go, Tracy. Follow me. Go past your fear. Follow me. And I'm like, okay. And I did it. That is a moment for me of going, I trusted you. I trust your abundance, Lord. So, Lord, we thank you for your tithes and your offerings, and we pray your blessings over them in the name of Jesus. And that is our opportunity to say we trust you. And that's our opportunity to invest in your kingdom. And to say that we trust the work that you're doing and to advance your kingdom in this world. Pray your blessings and your abundance, Lord, over each one today. And we thank you that your kingdom is different from ours. That the way you see things is different from the way we see them. We see as through a glass darkly, but you see the truth of every moment that we're in. Teach us to walk in the now. Teach us to rest in your limitless abilities. And we thank you for today. Thank you for the food that you've given us today, Lord. And may we take what we've learned today and bring it out into your world and talk to those that you put us in front of us. Pray your blessings, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.